says that he won't be here for the meeting. He is in out of state. Robert?
Present.
Pat?
Here.
And Walter on here.
Approval of the agenda?
Motion to approve the agenda.
Second.
Yes.
Pat?
Yes.
Robert?
Yes.
Approval of minutes, March 18th, 2015.
I looked at them. I didn't see anything. Looked okay to me. And if anybody has any questions, I'll make a motion to approve the minutes.
Second.
Number second. Jack?
Yep.
How do you vote?
Yes.
Pat?
Yes.
Robert?
Yes.
Okay, do I have a motion to adjourn as Board of County Commissioners and reconvene as Board of Finance?
I motion that we adjourn as Board of County Commissioners and reconvene as Board of Finance.
Second.
Second. Jack, how do you vote?
Yes.
Pat?
Yes.
And Robert?
Yes.
Okay, we have the A, monthly vouchers report. Do you have that one?
I can get after.
Huh?
I'll get it after.
Dylan?
guess so, huh?
Okay, you guys, I've had a chance to go over it. Any questions on the monthly, well, it's a voucher report, actually, it's a team act.
I had one question that I already talked to Joseph Paul earlier about. Page 27. And that was, page 27. And they explained that, so I didn't see anything else to, anybody have any questions? Make a motion.
Well, this one is, we don't have to vote on it, just any questions.
Yeah. No, I'm good with it.
Okay, any questions? Okay, monthly treasures report?
Madam Commissioner? Distribution for March 2015. I've got the state portion at $9,369.94. County portion at $69,160.83. The schools, $82,598.77. College, $5,348. City of Grants, $11,845.17. Village of Milan, $2,142.29. Camaldo School District, $2,886.42. Cibola General Hospital, $28,438.42. Flood, $1,437.06. Lava, $1,863.61. With the total distribution for March 2015 at $214,737.99. Any questions?
Almost a quarter of a million.
Thanks, man.
Jack? No, Robert?
No.
Thank you.
Now, investment report.
On the investments, we really haven't done much, other than opening up the public savings for the $13 million. We did that February, and we earned interest of $1,212.81 for that month. Other than that, we really haven't done any other investments.
Any questions, Robert?
Commissioner Chairman, Commissioner, if I could just interject with me. We are in the process of speaking with some of the other banks and getting some other information from them regarding whether investments that are available to us as well as being able to use. Early in the process, but we'll keep going.
And I'll go over that in the investment meeting, I believe, but the investment committee meeting is going to be Wednesday at 4:30.
Right.
Well.
What's Wednesday?
Wednesday. So we can be there both times.
Next Wednesday.
Next Wednesday.
That was meeting yesterday?
No, it was Friday. This coming Friday.
It's supposed to be Friday. It's supposed to be Friday, but it'll be Wednesday.
Okay.
Well, I knew there was a bunch of bank people here.
Yesterday.
The bank was, US Bank was here yesterday.
We had plans for it for Wednesday, right?
Yes.
Next Wednesday. Okay, thank you.
Any other questions?
Schedule of rents received. Oh, sorry.
Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, we are updating on all of our licenses. The two of our entities that are still renting space for us at the moment. I apologize.
ways that I could bring you potentially something on the Swiss lease about a new one. I mean, and I don't mean at a meeting to vote on, I mean in draft form and let you all take a look at it. We're having some give and take from them now at least, and we're having some good conversation about it. But it's tough, Mr. Chairman, when the lease was signed in 1977 and it had never been updated. And so the rent that they pay today is the rent that was set back in 1977.
Late 1900s, huh?
It may not be 77, it may be 73, I may be wrong, one of the two. And so I think that they do expect some sort of an increase. But I think that also gives us the opportunity, to be honest with you, of trying to prompt them to buy, because they're going to know that it's going to have to go up significantly.
Well, what price of gas in 1977 is related up to what the price of fuel is now, unfortunately.
I gassed up in, I graduated from college in 77, and I gassed up at the UGAS outside of Las Cruces, and I think it was under a dollar. So I think we're okay.
That's the rate of inflation.
4 years before that, they were having a gas crisis till 1973.
Well, 73, they were having.
Yeah. So I'm hoping to have that before you, but that's the difficulty when you're dealing with the lease that's over 30 years old. You know, you almost got to reinvent the wheel.
That's almost, what, 40 years that we've been, well, they have been doing business there, I guess you would say.
And again, just to remind the commissioners that anything that we would do with them, whether it would be an increase in rent or they actually buy, the plans would be to put that money right into that reserve fund on the payment back of the bonds of all that building. And so that could definitely help. Let's say the rent went to $20,000 a month. It creates $240,000 towards a $500,000 payment. That's how.
That could potentially, you know, help us pay the bond off sooner and save the county some money in the long run.
Well, that's about almost $7,000 a month. Okay. Any questions, Jack?
No.
Robert?
No.
Pat? Announcements. The next regular Board of Finance meeting will be held Wednesday, May 19th, 2015. At 5 p.m. Financial statements. Sorry. Joseph, this one will be yours.
Yes, Commissioner Chairman, just
statements.
Just a first brief summary that we're giving you all for the finances instead of wasting your time with huge piles of statements and wasting all the paper. And then, of course, if you all have any further questions, we can provide any documentation you would like. You know, you can see that we do have the bond money in there, and so that's showing that our revenue is quite a bit higher than what we would normally anticipate. But obviously, as soon as we start the project, we'll see the expenditures go up accordingly. But everything seems to be well underway for the end.
Questions?
No, to me.
Jack?
No.
Robert? Good. Now, announcements. Absent. And contrary. We'll follow with the pledge of allegiance.
Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Pat, can you just pray?
Heavenly Father, thank you for this beautiful spring that we've had so far. Today wasn't that pretty, but Sam didn't blow too bad. And thank you for all the people that are here. Pray that they all get home safely, and that we make the best decisions that we are equipped to make. Pray this in the name of Jesus Christ's name. Amen.
I have a motion for the approval of minutes for March 18th, 2015.
Motion to approve.
There's a motion.
Second.
And second. Robert, how do you vote?
Yes.
Jack?
Yes.
Pat?
Yes.
I vote yes. Reports, monthly sheriff's department activity report. Sheriff, does he like the community?
Yes.
Pat?
did another evaluation on New Mexico itself, on countywide. Cibola County, we're stuck right in the middle of three of the most violent counties in the whole state, Bernalillo, Valencia, and McKinley. On a flow chart of 1 to 100, Cibola County is right about 50%, so we're holding our own, so to speak. With that, I came back and checked some of the statistics through our records management system, and that's where I got the, we're up about 25% on our demands. Through that, I wanted to do some target some hotspots in our area. So, the hotspots for us throughout the county are Blue Water Village, Mount Taylor Edition, San Rafael, and the City of Grants. I'm going to focus right now targeted patrols on San Rafael, Blue Water Village, and Mount Taylor Edition. We'll partner up with the City of Grants with their police forces and see what we can offer them and go from there. So that's kind of what we're at right now.
It all depends on the population, because Grants would be higher because of the population.
Alaska is actually the first most violent state in the United States right now. I had some time to sit down with the new ASAC in charge of the FBI from on a national level. They believe New Mexico would be number one. Unfortunately, tribal agencies don't report, do their UCR reporting to the FBI unless it's an FBI investigation. So that kind of leaves New Mexico at number two. If those reports were coming in, we'd potentially be at number one.
How much training does your staff have? You know, we always see on TV, you know, police officers shooting, you know, civilians or civilians. Yesterday I just saw one that they had run over, but I mean, how much training do we have to defuse a situation? I mean, I know you guys haven't had that, but do we have a lot of training as to defuse a situation?
2 years ago, our Senate handed down House Bill, our Senate Bill, I forget the actual number, but what it is handling people with special needs, how to de-escalate a situation. For administrators, it's mandatory 8 hours. For patrol officers, it's 4 hours mandatory that we have to keep through DPS and also through the state. Every one of our officers is up to date on that. We're hosting Commissioner Arrio took a tour today of our office and some of the new monitors and stuff that we have for our training. We already hosted two trainings for all the local law enforcement. We're hosting another one next month for all law enforcement within the area to bring officers up to date on their current training, which we're mandated to have 40 hours every year, and it's under dealing with people with special needs, use of force, how to de-escalate situations. There's a whole chain of them. So we're not just doing it for us, we're doing it for all the agencies around. I believe that we haven't had any real use of force issues because I've been up to date with the training.
So you did have to change since you were an employee there? Thank you. Any questions? Sorry. Matt?
I'm good.
Robert?
No.
Thank you. Detention center.
Evening, Chairman and Commissioner.
Mike.
So, currently we have 100 major incidents. We selected four officers to fill the last four positions we had left. We should be starting academy on the 27th. We found a local psychologist to help us out. And one of the issues that we had was I spoke with Mr. Arnino about it once. Having people evaluated psychologically before we have them
revise it and, you know, cover it up or put a roof on it. I mean, they just wanted to clean it up a little bit and stuff, so thank you.
We should be done with it by Friday. Any questions, Jeff? Pat?
No, it looks like you've been busy over here.
We're always busy.
So, Robert?
No.
So how's your staff?
We got everything lined up, yeah.
Got my new hire form, not yet, they're gonna start.
They'll be starting.
No questions? No, that's it, we'll let you get busy.
Gary, thank you.
Public comment, the public has an opportunity to provide a comment at this time regarding any agenda item only. Your comment will be limited to 3 minutes unless the Board of Commissioners request more information. This time has been given as an effort to allow public input, but also move the agenda forward in a prompt and yet efficient manner. Any citizens to comment? Presentations, Tessa Jimenez, update on Chamber's marketing effort.
Good evening, gentlemen. We are part of the Team 66. There are several members of different community entities that are here tonight, and wanted to present to you the efforts that we've been doing regards to marketing the city of Grants and Cibola County as a tourism destination. The organization includes members of the city of Grants, Main Street, Economic Development, Future Foundation, the Chamber of Commerce, the Arts Council, NMSU, Cibola County, and the National Park Service. And we have met weekly for the last 2 months, and we just kind of wanted to present to you guys the hard work that we've done, and just so you can see the effort that we're making to try to market Grants as a tourism destination.
Good evening, Chair and Commissioners. The first thing that we started when we began this Team 66 Marketing Steering Committee, we wanted to change the logo for the City of Grants. And as we know, this is the current city logo, and we've officially changed it. And this is our new city logo. It highlights Mount Taylor, and we kept the Zia symbol and we put in that New Mexico sky. And it has a lot more color, a lot more pop, and we highlighted Route 66 because the longest stretch of Route 66 in New Mexico is here in Cibola County. And it's a big part of what we are, and we focused on that a lot, as you'll see through the presentation. And here are the two side by side. From this point, I'll pass it to Bianca Mitchell from Main Street, and she'll talk about new signage that we're working on and Grants.
Good evening, Chair, Commissioners. I'm Bianca Mitchell, the Executive Director for the Grants Main Street Project. During our committee meetings, we've also been talking about signage, wayfinding signage in the City of Grants. As you know, when tourists do come into Grants, they get lost a lot of the times going down First Street and have no way to get back out. So just as far as wayfinding signage, we have, you know, locations to identify where the galleries are, where the Riverwalk Park is, where the Chamber of Commerce is. And when you guys move, when the county complex moves, you know, we would have signage at the end of First Street and Roosevelt to direct them to, you know, the county County Complex, the Cibola General Hospital, and just really making the tourists feel comfortable and welcome when they get here by having the signage consistent throughout the City of Grants. And it tells people what's happening, what's going on in our community when we utilize the effective signage. It's just a lot easier for the tourists to navigate through our city here. So this slide shows signage locations that we identified. Of course, when you get off the interstate, both, well, get off of I-40, both east and westbound, at the McDonald's exit and then the exit at Walmart, as well as when you come into town on Santa Fe Avenue, which is the Route 66, having the wayfinding signage begin at First Street and Santa Fe Avenue. Going down First Street, you'll have directional signage at First Street and Roosevelt, so those that are lost or wanting to get out of Grants, they have directions to get back to I-40, or either if they're looking for the high school, there's that signage, as well as going up to Mount Taylor Summit, or again, the Cibola County Complex, the hospital, and a way to get to the golf course from First and Roosevelt. We've also identified the area by Roosevelt and, is that Lobo Canyon? To direct them, of course, up to the Mount Taylor Summit, and then at Sacolaris and Roosevelt, so they easily can have access again to Mount Taylor Summit or the golf course. The other location is as you're coming off the interstate at the Walmart exit, and you come to the Route 66, we would want signage there letting them know, welcome to Cibola County, you're on Route 66, and that's what we want to capitalize on, is Route 66. We have not really capitalized on Route 66, and so that was one of our main goals as well with the wayfinding signage and the promotional material that we'll be creating, as you see on the city logo. Do you have any questions or comments about where directional
like
signage
a good
should
idea.
Be?
I like the logo. Really good. Grants. I heard a great deal. I got another idea I had to bring to you from the other day. Driving through Milan, I saw the big tank at Petro. It's not painted or anything. If they let you paint something on that, that would be great.
Sure, I mean.
Something, I don't know. They probably, they may not, you know, let you do it or anything, but they might say, go ahead. But yes. If you'll go look, it's right on the freeway there. And, you know, when you go to Las Cruces, you see a lot of the tanks and stuff painted and down through there off of I-25.
And we're in the process right now of doing a presentation to the Village of Milan as well next month in May, so that we can get them on board as far as promoting Cibola County. But so far, this is just pretty much like the first phase of what our marketing committee, steering committee, Team 66 is doing right now. I'll go ahead and pass it on to Manuel Vasquez. He'll talk to you about the collaborations that we're working on with NMSU.
Mr. Chair, Commissioners, thank you for having us out here. At this point, I'd like to let you guys know that the signage that is there, it's not going to cost us anything other than possibly some labor. The signs are going to be coming off of the Coyote Mountain golf course, and those signs are going to be torn down by contract. They're going to be taken off, and that will become the property of the city. At that point, we are going to utilize those signs for our signage in our community, which won't cost us anything. Okay, the only thing that would cost us would be the sign being made, but those signs would actually be removed at any time for different events that we have going, as long as it doesn't interrupt the directions of to the hospital or the county complex, okay? But this is mainly going to be done by volunteers in some city park, but it's not going to cost us anything. The other thing is if we have Richard Gutierrez, which is a welding instructor at the college, he's going to be helping with these. Or if we need to move anything, he will be doing the welding. He will be doing the manufacturing of anything that we need to be doing to it. But this is an excellent program where it benefits not just the city, but also the county. Because we live in the county, and I think our group, Team 66, is moving in the direction where it just doesn't benefit us. It benefits the whole county. We have other ideas that are coming up for our signage, which Mr. Lewis will present to you. So this time, I'd like to ask you guys if there's anything that you guys want to know about the signage, how we can help, or you can help us.
Jack?
No, I just think it's a great idea because we were just up in Los Alamos and they have signage throughout their city there, and it sure makes a difference. You can get to those locations pretty quickly. So I think that'll, it just makes your town look more classy, I believe, and it looks like you guys are doing a great job, so thank you.
I gotta remind you, Jack, that's our town.
Yeah.
I think it's a great idea, Robert.
Thank you.
Well, I do like the idea in moving forward, you know, with, you know, as times go on, you know, you've always got to make changes, and it's good to see that we're going back to Route 66, trying to get people back on 66. I was just thinking, I wonder how many times that logo has changed in Grants. I remember one time it had those neutrons, or, you know, when it was the Capital World.
You must be older than I am, Walter.
The city of Well, you know, I always look at the history of Grants, you know. I just always like the history of Cibola County. And this next one looks like probably the best one yet.
At this point, I'd like to get Brittany up here to let you know about our lighting program we have going.
Going on with the Route 66 theme, we found this product that's a replacement for glass neon, and we'd like to put it up around town. I'm going to press play here. This product is virtually indestructible. It's weatherproof. It's made of LEDs. It's flexible. It lasts for about 36,000 hours, and if it's on for about 10 hours a day, that's about 8 years of use out of these lights. They're easy to install. They can be done by anyone, so city employees, anybody that's putting them up on buildings. It's easy. It takes minutes compared to how long it takes glass neon to be installed. It also uses much less energy than glass neon uses. This product actually uses about 10% of the energy that glass neon uses, so it's more environmentally friendly. It doesn't create hot spots. And as you can see, it's easy to use, it bends, it doesn't break. Here in a minute, they're going to run over it, and it doesn't break. So it's just something to think about, and the city is actually looking at ordering some for some of our buildings around town. And these are some examples. There's the city building at the Mining Museum as well. And we want to put this up where we can to get that Route 66 theme going. I'm going to pass it to Tessa, and she's going to go on with this Route 66.
Another initiative through this idea with the neon is to have people stay the night here. So they would come in later in the evening, spend the night, and then bring in more tax dollars to the county because, you know, that's overnight stays that we would have. Another attraction that we want to add to Route 66 would be this structure that would be in front of City Hall, where our caboose project was intended to go. And this would be a drive-through attraction that people could park their car underneath and take photos. It would have the neon flex on it as well, so it would be also a night attraction to add to those additional signs. And really with the technology and the way it's going now with digital images and Facebook and Instagram, getting our name associated with a location and out there to the public as much as we can is going to be a real big draw for us. As I mentioned before with the Caboose project, I don't know if you guys have noticed, but we did get the rails donated and they are in front of City Hall currently. Right now, that idea is to move those rails to another location on the other side of Route 66. It would be in between Milo's Law Office and Kenneth Brown Photography, right in front of the bank. And that would just be another attraction that would draw people into the town. Hopefully, eventually, that would possibly slow down the traffic on Route 66 on Santa Fe Avenue. because there would be more people walking in that area. So right now with this image, you would see that on the far right is where that drive-through arch would be, and then the caboose would be on the left. Initially, the first phase of the caboose would be to place the caboose there, put a fence around it, have it painted, and the door sealed. That way it would be more of a outdoor, you wouldn't necessarily go into it yet until we got the funding to refurbish the inside, but it would be a good photo op for people traveling down Route 66.
The railroad is part of our history.
Right, and we're hoping that the people with that own that property, we've kind of talked to them about the idea, and they're up for it because they could also use it for their photos. But the rail runs right back there, so it would be a really good picture if you caught both of them. Another tourism initiative that we're working towards is an application for your phone that is geared to activities to do just in Cibola County. It would be an easier functional way for people to plan their trips. They could go on there and log on and see if they have half an hour, what they could do in half an hour, if they wanted to extend their stay and do a whole overnight stay. It'd have an itinerary of items that we would suggest for them to do. It would list all the businesses and tourism-driven companies in the county. And it would also help our frontline people who, when people come into the gas stations and fill up and ask, what do you do in Grants? If you don't know, you can just say, download the app or check out this website. And it would help them at least know what's happening in our county. And we think it would be utilized by a lot of people. And it would be a free application that they could download for their phone. Really with the Chamber of Commerce, the focus is to become New Mexico True. We are currently today, tomorrow, and Friday filming a commercial for the county. We are hitting several different entities throughout the county. And this is a billboard that went up on the 13th. If you exit the exit at Walmart, you can see it, and there's one coming in from Milan as well. But once we get tagged on with the state initiative to become New Mexico True, they match our funding. So right now we have 15 billboards that haven't been updated in a while. This is one of the newer ones. I mean, 2 days ago it went up. So if you have a chance to drive out there or come in on that exit, take a look at it. But this is the feel of what we're trying to go towards, is showing that we are New Mexico True. And I have some flyers here because tomorrow at from 6 to 8, we're going to be having a concert in the amphitheater. The Desert Diamond Band is a local county band, and they are going to be singing the Route 66 song and the New Mexico True song. And the concert will be out here in the amphitheater, and the film crew is going to film the audience enjoying the concert. So we encourage everybody in the city and the county to attend that free event so we can fill that amphitheater and just show our pride in our city and what we're moving towards. This is a storyboard of the commercial that we're shooting. It's going to start with a couple, and initially it was a couple, but we changed that to be a family because we are a family-friendly community. They'll be driving down Route 66. Some of the historical monuments that they're going to be featured at would be the sandstone bluffs, the arch. They will be going up to Sky City and taking views of that. The next one. They'll be going out to Mount Taylor and Blue Water Lake, and also hiking. We did the hiking shot this afternoon at the Junction Cave, which is up by El Calderon. And then it'll end with the scene in the amphitheater where the band is playing, and they're enjoying an evening. And so it starts at sunrise. It started at scenes from the golf course at sunrise, and then this will be the ending at the sunset. It is a 30 second shot that lodgers tax is funding through the chamber, but through that we'll be able to put the spots out with funds from the state in different locations. Right now, the markets that we're looking at right now would be Albuquerque, Santa Fe, and Las Cruces. And the state would probably branch onto that and go to Phoenix and Denver and larger areas where tourists come in from. And Sherry will next speak on Team 66 behalf for Eileen Yarbrough, who is out of town.
And as she said, I'm stepping in for Eileen, so I just got the speaking notes this morning. So forgive me if I read a bit to you. So recently the county paid $55,000 to a professional consulting firm for a 2015 Cibola County Comprehensive Plan. In that report, they stated that tourism provides the best opportunity for growth and investment in Cibola County. And this project is a way for the county and the city to make money, not to spend it. So I want you to remember that. So for economic development, one of the goals is to increase revenues or gross receipts taxes for Cibola County. And we plan to do that by increasing the number of visitors to Grants and Milan and other localities in the country. Also by increasing the number of overnight stays in hotels, RV parks, and other places. So in other words, heads and beds, because that's what makes the money. Also by increasing sales and productivity and production in retail establishments and restaurants. And this will in turn increase the need for employment. And 80% of job creation comes from existing businesses. Also, tourism is the low-hanging fruit. So we really want to try and capitalize on the Route 66 theme. This will generate the largest amount of revenue or return on investment for the amount of investment that we make. Why? Because tourists come, spend the night, and then leave. So we're not required to provide ongoing or long-term services for them, such as police, fire, and roads. However, the money that they spend contributes to an increase in gross receipts, which may pay for such services and infrastructure for our citizens. It also helps to put Cibola County on the radar as far as tourism is concerned. Grants, Milan, and Cibola County are now New Mexico True, and there are many historic and significant state and national parks, monuments, and others to showcase throughout the county. We have a diverse culture contributing to an array of artisans, such as potters, silversmiths, rug weavers, painters, sculptors, and dancers. We also have a huge demand and market for these art. So for things such as pottery, jewelry, paintings, carvings, and sculptures. We currently have a collaboration between entities that's helping for this effort. But moving forward, we will continue and we will need more entities to join our collaboration just to make sure it's an ongoing effort and an ongoing success. We also would like to expand the tourism sector to diversify the tax base. This will increase revenues through gross receipt taxes, and also create a destination with quality of life assets that will increase tourism visits and increase citizenship in Cibola County, and which in turn will help increase the perceived value in our localities and appreciate property values in Cibola County. And I'm going to hand it over to Maddie.
Thank you. This is something that Tony Mason, Tony, can you come up here? Been working on with the help of the Team 66, how we're trying to sell the county. And at this time, I'd like to approach you guys and show you a copy of what we're trying to do, and we can explain it to you.
Explain it. What we're doing is we have a 1950 Chevy car. I know all of you have heard about the Cadillac Ranch or Welcome to Las Vegas. Those things attract thousands of people every year into those local communities. What we have done is we've acquired a 1950 Chevy. I've been working on it for about a month now. We're gonna seal it up, paint it up, make it look real pretty, put it down here on Route 66 and make it stationary, create another photo opportunity picnic place for people from the public to actually stop in our community and have an opportunity to take a photo with that and actually get them to come into Route 66 and stop and stay a while.
This sign is, hopefully we can get the city to buy into this. We present it to the county first because we want to make sure that you can see that we're actually doing everything or leading the people outside. Once they're in Grants, they stay at the motel or go to one of the park services, and they could stay all day there, but they have directions on how to get there. And that's in our county, not in the city. And I think that the county would see that that would benefit our tax basis a lot for our county. And it's a working project in progress, and with the Team 66, they've went through it and wanted some more changes, so we're working on that, getting a little more changes, but we already have the car in possession. It's cleaned out. It's ready to go to the body shop, so we're moving this real quick. The sign is going to be coming off of the hill from Walmart, where Central Auto Garage is. There's a vacant lot next to it, which belongs to the city, and we're hoping that we can put that sign there. And that'll be the first thing that'll catch your eye as you're coming into Granted, which is signage again, and directions to the places that we have in our community. The car's going to be stationary, like Tony said. It's going to be bolted down, and hopefully you can see that we are pushing for things outside of our city and into our county. And if there's anything you guys would like to add to it, or give me an idea of how we can move on this in any other way to help the county, let Tony and myself know, or you can let Tessa know at the Chamber of Commerce. Any questions? Tessa wouldn't let me put my Pontiac there, okay?
No, it's going to look nice. I like the direction you guys are going on. Route 66, and like you said, it involves the whole county, you know, starting from Mesita all the way to the Pruitt, I guess. And then state the county line ends around Pruitt.
Yes, sir.
After Pruitt, right?
Yes, sir.
I don't see the village of Milan on there. Have you approached them?
The village of Milan, it runs through there. But we are going to make different changes.
That's 66, too.
Yes, sir, it is.
Now, you guys are, I've been hearing about this project, but I'm really amazed to see how far you guys have gone and how you guys are working together and commandant among each other. You know, it takes a whole bunch of heads to work in. Jack, I mean, like you said, you already mentioned that you've seen this in other communities. And it is, we need the signage. Even though Grants is a small town, people do get lost. You know, the signs, at least to get them back on track. Robert?
Thank you.
Well, we thank you guys for your time. And then we did make a replica of what the one of the attractions would look like. It's sitting over here if you'd like to look at it. But like you said, Walter, this really is a group effort. That was part of the reason why, too, we each presented a section. It wasn't just one person doing all this, because we can't. It takes all of us cooperating to want to get this stuff done.
To get off of the subject, I guess it is on the subject. And you guys are the same ones that are taking the lead as to what's going to partake of this convention center. So I feel confident that you guys will have a good idea here in a couple of years what this convention center will be.
We'll have it before you guys move out.
Mr. Chairman, may I make a comment, please?
Yes, sir.
Good evening, commissioners, Mr. Chairman, and Mr. Manager. My name is Michael Lewis. I'm a city councilor here in the city of Grants, representing District 4. And I just wanted to inform you about how the city is involved in this project with Team 66. We hired a full-time marketing director, Brittany here, who helped design our logo and who's helping us move along with all these important images that are involved in what you're seeing. We're very proud of what they've done and very impressed with what they've done. But as you know, most of our important attractions right now are actually outside of our city, and they're in the county. So the city has also started a line item on their budget for just marketing. And what I'm here tonight to ask you to do is to join us in that effort, since we are promoting the county, that you would help in some way. The city started with a budget of $50,000 that is used for just these things, just these items, signage. Actually, we do have to buy the steel for making these signs. We have partnered with the college up here, and they are going to fabricate the signs, but we have to pay for the material. So we're here as a city to ask you to get on board with us and provide a line item in your budget this coming year that would, I would propose that the Chamber of Commerce Board of Directors would decide how that money is spent on these items. But Tessa would provide you with a monthly or a quarterly report of what we're spending the money on. And but the steering committee, this group that is comprised of various groups here in town and all the folks who are involved in tourism, they would be the ones that would decide where to spend the money that you provided. So it's just a request. We would ask that you would help the city with the funding that is involved. Most businesses spend from 3 to 8% of their total budget on advertising and promoting, especially businesses that are involved with tourism, and which this town and county is. So right now we basically have only lodgers tax money to spend on promoting and advertising, and that amounts to about $250,000. So we'd like to get that number up to about $500,000 eventually, or $600,000 to spend on promoting our community. But right now the city started with a budget of $50,000, and we'd like to ask the county to get on board as well at some level. Thank you.
So the city is the lead agent in this project, or is it the chambers?
Say again, Walt.
So who's the lead in this project? Is it the city or is it the chambers?
Well, the chamber is actually leading this effort. But they have included and asked the steering committee is made up of representatives from the city, the chamber, Main Street, the county. Parks Department, and of course Main Street. I need somebody else. And Economic Development. Eileen's actually on this committee too. So the county is represented in these ideas, and they helped bring it along. So that's an answer to your question.
Thank you. Definitely should join in those efforts. You know, we have to promote our county. Most of these entities are within the county. You know, we have the Laguna, the Bluffs, the Blake, like he says, Mount Taylor. Thank you.
Chairman,
go ahead.
I am a member of the Group 66.
Why don't you step up to the mic and state your name?
Mr. Chairman and Commissioners, my name is Mitzi Frank. I'm a relatively new superintendent for the National Park Service for Elmo Pais National Monument and El Moro National Monument. And I was fairly recently asked to join the Team 66, and I feel very privileged that they would want my participation. Mm-hmm. And I just wanted to let you know that the National Park Service supports any activity or programs or projects that would help bring tourism to Grants and to Cibola County. And anything that we can do to help that and to help promote that, we're willing to do that. And then also, too, anything that this team or the city or the county wants to do to use us to promote, meaning the National Park Service and these two monuments, to promote tourism, we're happy to, again, to participate. I have never been so impressed with a group of people as I am with this group here. I've been a member now, or a citizen of Grants and Cibola County for just a year. And these people here, I mean, I've never seen such go-getters in my life. They're really committed to making things happen for Grants and Cibola County. And I think any support that any of us can show this group and these people for the efforts they've done, I think we should try to do that. So, thank you.
Thank you. Do you have a got no cowboys on your board? Ranchers, rodeo guys?
Mr. Chairman, we've had an opportunity to meet with the committee and with Councilman Lewis as well, and the plans from the administration standpoint was to create a line item, put a dollar figure in there of starting with a match of $50,000 with the city in the draft budget. And that way you all would at least have the opportunity to look at that and make decisions from that standpoint.
That'd be great.
They have formally come in and made that request and gave us a preview of this. And so that's from the staff's standpoint, you have that opportunity during the budget hearings to take a look at that.
Well, it's an investment, definitely. You know, tourism, it's here. Especially the apps, I like those, you know, apps and everything. That really would make a big difference, especially when people know about grants, they just tell them to upload the apps. Anything else with the chambers? Arthur or Tuesday, update us more transit.
Since 2008, they first hired me as a driver, and like Gary was saying, asked me if I wanted to fill in for that in-house dispatch position. And I accepted it, but I didn't realize how challenging it was being. Boy, my dispatch basically consists of scheduling, constantly fielding phone calls and logging all the necessary information, checking the time slot availability for all these clients that are calling in, and contacting the available drivers, relaying the said information, and preparing their daily and weekly logs that they can follow throughout the day. And then just the basic our service needs are, the people that we serve in the community are, we have regular dialysis patients that we take to dialysis three times a week. A lot of doctor's appointments, people that want to go to the community pantry, human services, a lot of court appointments, compliance, counseling, such as Valle del Sol and Sierra Vista, CYFD, a lot of people like to go up there, have needs to go over there. And then you got your shopping, people that like to go shopping, and job commute back and forth to work. And also we do quite a few ladies from Roberta's place, and also the college. We do some students that we take over there on a daily basis. And I was saying earlier that it's a challenging position, that dispatch position. And I have the numbers that we're averaging just under 100 calls a week, a day. And for example, the month of March, the first week that I was there, we came up with a total of 512 calls. The next week was 495. The next week was 505, and 373 after that, for a grand total of 1,885 calls to dispatch for transit service. And just being out in the field, you know, driving. And then behind the desk as a dispatcher, I can just attest to how important the transit system is to our community. And I think it's a good thing. I just hope you support it. And if you have any questions, we'll be happy to try to answer them.
Let me just talk about the last change that we made. We adopted the brand name, the Carrot Express.
What was
that? The Carrot Express.
Oh, the Carrot.
Ridership. This is the key to the entire program. We have seen a slight decrease because of the change, but they are very minimal. We have favorable responses from riders. I believe there are two factors for the favorable responses. One, every rider or potential rider is picked up at their residence, taking to their destination. And two, during inclement weather, who wants to be at a bus stop waiting for a bus in the cold? February ridership totals were 2,320. March ridership totals were 2,485, an increase of 165. Let me just wrap up. I work in the same building with Commissioner Valeris. He told me not to butter him up, but I'm gonna talk about him. He's an intelligent, he's professional, he's a very kind person. He's a working supervisor. He'll get the shovel and go out there and cut the weeds and everything. And I'm not comparing public transportation and school bus transportation, but I believe, though there are two similar parts. One is a rigorous maintenance program. You need to make sure your vehicles are safe and reliable. And two, new route service. Commissioner Molares ran Mesa Transportation for many years, and I asked him lots of questions. The Transit Board has been presented with providing new route service. It's fully discussed, and we have adopted a theory that to establish new route service, it meets the cost-effective test. So we need a minimum of 7 potential riders, and I think Commissioner Morales told me that that's the same theory. The reason I bring this up is the board approved on a trial basis service to the Acoma Pueblo. And we went to the Pueblo on November 4th, 2014, it picked up two riders. December 2014, two riders. January 2015, zero riders. So the board decided to end the service. I can stand before you today and tell you we did our best. Thank you again for the opportunity to update you. We're happy to answer any questions you may have.
So, Robert, do you have any questions? Pat?
No.
Jack?
No, just thank you, Arturo. I think the transit system is essential to our area because there's a lot of people that aren't as fortunate as ourselves that this provides that service to. And, you at one time you did have a fee on there, and you yourself, you never wanted to increase that. As for no fee, it could work both ways, but at least it's not going to be a burden on the people that really do need the rides. There's no excuse for them not getting on and participating. So, it is essential. We need that for our community, especially for elderly and just like I said, those that aren't as fortunate as ourselves. So, I hope it continues, and I don't know how many years we've assisted with the program, but
we're part of it when it started.
So, to our knowledge, we'll be participating, as much as we can.
So it's like a taxi service now?
That's what a lot of people call it, a taxi service, but you can call it taxi service. The official, the wording that the state uses is demand response.
Yeah. No, it is definitely a need. Every community needs one, and it's, I guess they can use it for whatever they want, whether to go to dialysis or whether to go to Walmart. It sounds like you're pretty flexible. What is the cost to it?
No cost.
No cost.
At first, we originally had a fair policy of 50 cents within Milan and 50 cents within Grants, a dollar from Milan to Grants, and a dollar vice versa from Grants to Milan. And then, being a veteran, I decided that I'd like to see, and I took to the board, veterans ride free and seniors ride free. The reason for that was veterans willing to pay the ultimate sacrifice to the nation, and seniors are on a fixed income. And then recently when we went through these changes of no more fixed route service, we made the change to no more fares.
That's a good service.
What's
a lot of people use it now.
What are the hours? Is it 24 hours?
We don't have 24 hours. What we have is Dennis, I, and two drivers come in at 7. We wanted to get people getting to work on time before 8. And we take calls from 7 to 4, and then they can leave a message. And then we have a couple of the other three drivers that work 8 to 5, and the driver works from, we have flexible hours. One that works from 7 to 11 takes a break and then goes back from 2 to 6. The driver that comes at 10 and works at 7. So we're running till 7 at the latest.
So no rides to outlaws. Oh, Tessa?
I just wanted to speak on behalf of the Karen Express. On the 25th, we're having 15 pilots that are coming, going to fly into the Milan Airport. And once they're here, they don't have vehicles, but they're going to be spending the two nights here in the county and the city. And we're going to utilize the Carrot Express to get those pilots to different locations throughout the city and the county. And also, trying to bring in more tourism, there's different events that we're trying to bring conferences. And if they come in a group, that we can, shuttle them to different locations if their, meetings are at different times. So I think Art's doing a really good job up there. And I try to promote it as much as I can to get more people to utilize that benefit that we have here. So, thank you.
That was definitely part of your
hotels to get any tourists to call you guys from the hotels?
Dennis.
Yeah, that's one thing that we should get out there is the number to a, like a poster or something in the hotels about the transit system. And I was talking to Marty about that, getting our poster somehow just so that we know who to call if we need to go anywhere. So. Get a lot of requests for that. Not to go to the casino.
That's a different all to go. No, it definitely is an effort. The county did join in with Lon and the city. And there was three of us that kind of jumped in there. I'm hoping that they're all still going to continue that. Mike?
Chairman, Commissioner, if I might add real quick, coming from the detention of the criminal justice act, industry, I'm not sure exactly how much you deal with that. Recidivism is a really big problem in the criminal justice industry, and providing transportation for those people that need to get to courts, that need to get to therapy, and all those other places is a really key component to, I think, increase your rights.
Yeah.
I think Dennis mentioned the compliance issue.
Yeah, we do a lot of compliance.
People that go to the compliance, to the detention center, to their court appearances and everything, so we do a lot of that.
No, it's definitely a good project, and it should continue, and I think it will. On the county's part, anyway.
Thank you, Eric.
Sherry from Future Foundation. And I still haven't learned how to pronounce your last name.
It's okay, good evening, Commissioner.
Get you risky.
Patrick, that's right.
Did he get it?
Okay.
He probably.
So everything is going great so far at the Family Center. We have our after school program, which did take a break during the spring break session. But we're back in it, and we have our usual number of students, about an average of 90 students participating each day. We also have our regular programs. We are still facilitating our Big Brother Big Sister program. Currently have, I believe, 7 Big Brothers Big Sisters. We are also still doing our our bouncing baby boogie class, what we just call the baby bounce. So that is available to anyone for free with a child between the ages of 6, 3, and 4 years, actually up to 4 years. And it's free every Wednesday from 10 to 11. We also have our partnership with Rotary, which is we facilitate the youth council or the youth coalition, which is also called the GHS Interact Club. Currently, they are trying to raise money to buy stuffed animals to take to the children's hospital in Albuquerque, where they will have time to spend time with children there and try and help them, those that are that are sick or ill, and give them some comfort or some happiness during that time. They're also raising money to match that and send stuffed animals over to a children's hospital in a third world country. We also have our CTG program, or Community Transformation Project, which is in the city to start getting the Legacy Trail started. They are working on phase one, so that is in progress. We have also been hosting community blood drives. Our next one will be on May 14th, so and that will start from 3 p.m. until 6 p.m., I believe. They might even be there till 8. We are in the third round of our teen pregnancy prevention program. We have, I believe, 18 students that will be graduating in May. They are required to do so many hours of service learning. It's community service with a service, with a learning aspect to it. So we talk about why they're going to do this community service, who it will affect, and then after they've done the service, they talk about what they've learned and how that they feel that they had an impact. We also are working on our community garden, as well as getting our soccer field back up and going. We are starting to water. We will be fertilizing the soccer field soon. We will be getting the sand shortly to top dress the field.
We have started our seedlings for the community garden, and we've been showing the kids in the spring break program as well as the after-school program on how to start seeds to grow their own food and how they can start their own small gardens in their own backyards. We also have, we've completed our Girls Night Out Paint the Town Red event. It was a successful evening. Unfortunately, I was unable to attend, but from what I've heard, everyone who did attend really did enjoy it. We have also facilitated our interagency allegiance meetings with the Health Council, and we're focusing on obesity prevention for youth and families, as well as substance abuse prevention. And with that, we're trying to create a program in conjunction with CYFD as well as other partners in the community to try and get information out to fathers who are facing substance abuse issues. So that is something that we're trying to possibly mirror after a program that's available in Albuquerque, where they have a voucher system where people who have these issues can go and get referred to various places that can give them the help that they need. So we're trying to get the information out to anyone who needs it. So.
That's essential to our community because AYSO, I believe that's one of the reasons that they are at the golf course due to not having a place to have the soccer games.
And that is our ultimate goal, is to allow that field, to have that field available, but not until it's safe for it to be used.
Yeah. I think this is Bernie's first summer night.
This past summer,
yeah, it was just first.
Yeah, because they'll have that one also in Milan. There, we've been working on one over there also, so that'll also be available. But if we're able to have a couple of them, that would really be good for the community too. So, thank you.
Consideration of call for ordinance 1501 land use. Pat, you sat on that last meeting. Do we need to
I need to have one more meeting with a few more people, and I just haven't been able to set that up. So I would, we're working on it, but I think we need to table it at this time.
consideration of bid number 1501, Plano, Colorado, culvert crossing repair.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. As you said, bid 1501 is for Plano, Colorado, culvert crossing repair. We opened the bids on March 20th. There were three companies who responded to the bids. Those are listed in front of you. And we did, on the day of bidding, notice the discrepancy between the low bid of $28,763.28 and the other two, somewhere in the area of the high 60s. Visited with Starling Construction, gave them the opportunity, which you're allowed to under the law, to pull the bid out within 24 hours. Had they missed something in there, and their comment was it went back and double checked, and they didn't miss anything in there, that they felt their bid was good and they wanted it to move forward. So based upon that, is the recommendation of the purchasing department and the administration that we award bid number 15-01 to Starling Construction Company Incorporated in the amount of $28,763.28.
I motion that we do accept Starling Construction's bid for 15-01 for the Plano, Colorado culvert crossing repair.
For $28,763.
Yeah, before you motion that, you said that everything was comparable to the other two bids? Everything was?
Correct. Yes, sir.
It seems like it's really low compared to the other two.
And that's exactly what gave them the opportunity, should they had. Sometimes when you read, they just stick together and you don't pick up that or this, but he went back and looked and said he was very comfortable.
Yeah, they had six, seven plans, I'm sure. Right.
I got a question, Gary. Have you ever worked with these guys before?
No, none of them.
You haven't?
None of them. I've never even heard of them.
You feel comfortable with these guys?
Yeah.
You do?
Yeah. I was out there with them, but I never heard of them.
I'm just asking because, it's a big difference.
Yeah, it's a small job, but it's worth it.
So, leave the third discussion. You'll have to make another motion.
I motion that we accept Starling Construction Company's bid of $28,763.28 for Plano, Colorado culvert crossing repair.
Second. We have a second. Mayor Robert. Robert, how do you vote?
Yes.
Pat?
Yes.
Jack?
Yes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The next item is consideration of bid 15-02, material hauling on an as-needed basis. This bid was duly advertised and opened on March 20th. We had one vendor that responded, C&E Concrete. They have a price per hour with gross receipts, total cost per hour of $97.09, and then they have a price per ton, gross receipts tax, and a minimum of 20 miles. And this is exactly what we had asked in the bid itself, and being the only bidder, it is the recommendation of purchasing and also of the road department that we award bid number 15-02 to C&E Concrete Incorporated as presented.
Any discussion? Questions? Jack?
No.
Robert?
No.
Pat?
No.
So what is the wishes?
I'm going to motion that we award C&E Concrete bid number 15-02 material hauling as needed basis.
Second. We have a second. Jack, how do you vote?
Yes.
Pat?
Yes.
Yes. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The next is consideration of bid 15-03 for the purchasing of base course. It was duly advertised and bids were open on March 20th. We had one vendor, C&E Concrete. Their price was both from one pit and then from the Milan C&E yard. Those were the bid specifications. Total cost per ton, $13.59 and $20.50. It is a recommendation of purchasing and the road department that you accept and award this bid to C&E Concrete Incorporated to supply base course at the amount as presented.
Any discussion?
Yeah, what's the, how come it's cheaper from Tinaja?
Because it's further.
Huh?
It's further.
Oh, okay.
They'd have to haul it.
Yep.
Robert?
No questions.
Pat?
No, I'm good.
Do I have a motion?
I motion that we award C&E Concrete bid number 15-03.
Second it.
Jack, I mean, Robert, how do you vote?
Yes.
Jack, how do you vote?
Yes.
Pat?
Yes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Next is consideration of bid 15-04 to provide clean chips. This is a bid to provide 2,000 tons of half-inch clean chips. We had one vendor respond, C&E Concrete Incorporated. The bid specifications asked for the different sites, Walter Road, Dwight Small Road, Betty Drive, Golden Acres, and Parsons Lane. Those were the areas that the road department had requested. Based upon the bids and meeting the requirements, the purchasing and the road department recommends the award of bid 15-04 one ton to 2 tons half inch clean chips to C&E Concrete Incorporated as the bids as presented.
Any discussion?
Who are the other potential bidders? Do you know?
I don't think there was any more.
I don't think there was.
And Mr. Chairman and Commissioner, had they bid, it would have had to be on this sheet for presentation. So there was nobody that bid. Just like the other one.
Yeah.
We can't just deliver the sheet to the commission with just the one that we're recommending. It has to have everyone that was opened up.
Any more discussion? Do I have a motion?
Make a motion to approve 15-04 to C&E.
Second. Do the second. Jack, how do you vote?
Yes.
Pat?
Yes.
Robert?
Yes.
I vote yes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The next is consideration of resolution 15-17, budget adjustment number 4 for the fiscal year. I'd ask Joseph to make a presentation to the commission.
Mr. Chairman, commissioners, these are just some budget adjustments we're needing to do for the end of the year. The first one being a grant that was actually awarded for emergency management that was signed after we had approved the final budget and was not adjusted. So that's also a revenue handling expenditure for the same amount that we're increasing. The other one is the money that we're getting ready to put forth for the architect services for the remodel of the La Mesa Mall. So that's just an expenditure that will come out of that bond revenue, but we have to have that expenditure on the books. The last one is to help out at the road department for additional projects that they have been working on this last year, as well as a shortfall in revenue for our homeless nets, because that actually was impacted later than what we had originally anticipated. So we're having to put some money in there to help cover that. And again, that's a transfer as well as the increase of that expenditure.
Any questions or discussion? Jack?
No.
Robert?
No.
Pat?
No.
Do we have a motion to approve the adjustment?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The next item is consideration of plats that have been pre-approved.
Well, we didn't vote on that.
We haven't voted on
that. Oh, I'm sorry. I thought.
I'm going to make a motion that we pass resolution number 15-17, budget adjustment number 4 for fiscal year 2015.
Second.
We have a second by Robert. Jack, how do you vote?
Yes.
Pat?
Yes.
Robert?
Yes.
And I vote yes.
consideration of plats. What I'd like to do is, there's three of them. They've been pre-approved administratively. I did talk with Anna this afternoon. She had another conflict, asked if I wanted her to break it, asked her if there was anything out of the ordinary on these, and there was none whatsoever out of the ordinary on these. And so she's not here tonight. But I'd like to take them, if I could, give you the summary of all three of them. I think you can make them in one motion and a second and approval. Before we vote, I'd be happy to answer any questions you may have. The first is a summary, claim of exemption. It's a division of land created by a court order where the order creates no more than one parcel per part. The 13th Judicial District created four parcels in accordance with the degree set forth by the state of New Mexico. It did go through all of the plats checklists and all the appropriate fees, and hearings have been held, and it does come with recommendation of that department for approval. The second is for lands at the Mirabal and Colt Joint. It's for to divide Section 35 into two tracts. It is allowed, and the claim of exemption is based on the sale, lease, or other conveyance of land that creates no parcel smaller than 140 acres. When they originally had, when these people had filed a while back ago, many, many years ago, the filing was not exactly correct, and this will then allow to split the land between the families, the Marbach and the Pope Joyce, in Section 35, Township 10 North, 14 West. And then the Davis Ranch LLC, which is plat track 1 and 2 of the Davis Ranch, they claim that the exemption 13, and that is to divide Section 15 into two tracts. Again, all of the preliminary paperwork have been approved, all of the hearings have been held, all of the fees have been paid, and the title information checked. And they do come with the recommendation of that department as well for adoption. So it does come with the recommendation of the administration for the adoption of all three, consideration of plats as presented to the commission this year. Be happy to answer any questions you, the commissioner, have, Mr. Chairman.
Any questions?
Jack, I took through it all. It's all the necessary things are checked off. I see no reason not to do this. Not to do all three of them.
It's $11,200 grant. we match it with the $1,100 for $12,320. What I'd like to ask the commission, they talked to DFA, and Visa did, and DFA gave them 10 days in order to get the resolution adopted by the commission. Resolution, Mr. Chairman and Commissioners, is just a very simple resolution. All it does is authorizes county to enter into an agreement with the local government division for this judicial juvenile adjudication fund grant. So that came in late, unfortunately, by a day. We had already posted the agenda, and so it was too late to change it. The second item that Commissioner Armijo and I had talked about is he received a document that we were supposed to receive in the mail, and we still may, but it is a document that is asking the commission to establish a memorandum of understanding between Cibola County and the USDA Forest Service, the Cibola National Forest. They are going to revise the existing 1985 Cibola Forest Plan as required by the Forest Management Act. They have reached out to several entities to be cooperating entities and asking each entity, I think, to appoint two officials to a committee that would then be the sounding board and collect information to make comments towards the revision of the forest plan. If it would meet the desire of the chairman and the commission, we could also put this MOU on a very small 10 or 15 minute county commission meeting if we could find a date sometime next week where a quorum of the commission could be. I think it could take care of business very quickly. We have the MOUs, we can get them out to you. We would have to do the 72-hour a notice, but that way, in other words, if you would agree on something tonight, we could post on Friday. You could meet on Monday evening if you wanted. We could post Friday at lunch. You could meet Friday at Monday at lunch. You could meet Tuesday, Wednesday, whatever day you would. We could get a quorum there. Would be a day that we'd like to take care of those two items. I apologize that the grant paperwork was not done in time. Just one of those items that they ran into. But I do think it's worth having a meeting for it so we could get the $11,000. Is there one day or one time that's better than not?
Well, it would probably be easier, I know, after, you know, maybe at 5 o'clock. Would 5 o'clock work with you any day next week?
Yeah.
How about your brother?
That's fine.
That?
Yeah.
Next week?
I might not be.
Yes, if we had a quorum of three, that would be fine.
What day?
Mr. Chairman, that would be up to you. One comment I would have is, how many, Mr. Chairman, I know you're on the investment committee. How many, is there another one on the investment committee?
Well, Jack's been
I've attended, but I'm at...
Okay, I know that they're going to meet Wednesday at 4:30, but... Yeah, I mean, they could meet Wednesday at 4:30. If that would make it simpler for you all, we could have a meeting Wednesday evening at 5 p.m. What we would do then is we would utilize Friday to post, and I don't know if we've hit the deadline where we'd be able to publish. If we've already hit a deadline?
No, okay. You could turn it
so
in the morning.
We could then have the meeting published, and we could post. We could meet Wednesday at 5 p.m. if that's the desire of the commission.
I wonder what they're going to ask for in the MOU.
Well, Mr. Chairman and Commissioner Simpson, in the MOU, they're simply at this point asking...
It's on the forest road plan.
Right, and they're simply asking to have two people represent Cibola County on a committee that will help help vet, if you will, all of the comments that they get as they put the final plan together to revise the existing 1985 plan. So, go ahead, Commissioner, I'm sorry.
Well, it was explained to me that they're getting people from different communities and stuff, land grants, everything together. Washington said, you guys put the rules, we'll send them to us, we'll go over, we like them, we'll pass them. They said, because they're making the rules and the people don't like it. So what they want to do is they want to get a committee together from here. You guys decide what you want, send them to us, and then we'll go from there.
They want to get a committee together and try to convince us all to do what they want to do. And then all the citizens are going to be wanting our heads, is what's going to happen.
Well, the citizens are invited to all those meetings.
I guess you need to see what they have to say.
Commissioner, I would think it would be very important. I understand your point. But I do think it's important that we would not pass on at least having representatives from Cibola County there. So would it be Wednesday at 5 p.m.?
You know what? We have to be some of these other guys, because I
would be. Well, as I said, I'm for sure we could come, you know, three of us will be here, and then we'll.
And then we'll contact Commissioner. Okay, we'll do that. The second item I had is a couple of quick announcements. One is next Wednesday, the 22nd, the New Mexico Association of Counties is going to have their legislative update meeting for this part of the state here in Grants. It's from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. It will be right here in this room. There'll be updates by the county about legislation that impacted counties. Whether it was legislation that passed, failed, what sort of hearing it got or not. There will also be lunch served. Our probate judge, by title of being on the board, has taken this under her wing, worked with Amanda, and wanted to make sure that you all knew it was occurring. It's come and go, and we'd like to invite you to be there. Mr. Chairman, I'm sure that they're going to reach out to you if you're available and ask you to give a welcome. That either that morning at 10 or at the lunch that day.
So we'll host the lunch.
We'll host the lunch, yes, sir. Okay. On dates, we have coordinated with the health department in Santa Fe, and we'd like to announce a grand opening and ribbon cutting of the health office on May 19th. The Secretary of Health, herself, can make on that date, and several of the other top administrators. The plan would be to have people walk through and have tours from 4 to 5 to officially cut the ribbon and to christen it, if you will, whatever the function is, at 5, and then to allow for drinks and some small snacks there. This would be a total community-wide celebration of the brand new million-dollar county health building that will anchor the corner of the government center there on Roosevelt Drive. So May 19th at 4 p.m., we will be getting more notices out to you for that. That's a Tuesday night.
That's the day before our meeting.
That's the day before your meeting, yes, sir.
Next month's meeting.
Yes, sir. And last thing I'd like to go over, as you know, Friday was the deadline for applications for the county manager's position. When you do those, we wait until Monday, close of day, because by law, if it was postmarked on Friday, then it would, and received on Monday, it would be eligible to be received. And so we have received 13 applications/resumes from 13 different individuals. According to the schedule that we had talked about at the very first, I'd like to propose that right now, within the next couple of days, Debbie is performing, making sure that before you looked at them, all the applications meet the requirements, the basic requirements that we had, and is doing that and putting the file together. The plan would be then from next Monday the 20th to the following week, the 30th. So for two full 5-day weeks, we would have the file in the commissioner's office. They're in the county manager's office there, and the file would contain all 13. What we ask commissioners to do is stay, keep the files in there. We're concerned about any information, just vital information that if we make five copies of it, everybody takes five copies home, we haven't sorted. And so they will be available at any time. You also have keys that should it be afterwards. Did they put the keys back on that board? Okay, I'll get them put back in the morning. I thought they already had gotten them back, put back. That you all would be able to come in any time then, be able to review that. We ask simply one thing. We ask that you rank those 13 after reviewing them, 1 through 5. Okay? And we'd like to ask you to turn in a list when you're finished, whether it's the 21st or the 30th. Turn in a list to Debbie for her to keep of your top 5 by name and by ranking. So if you went through it and you thought Steve Smith was number 1, Mary Jones was number 2, and so on, if you'd rank those 5. Okay. We will take all 5 commissioners' individual rankings. We will add them up. We will see if we have a consensus then of 5. And then we'll come back to the commission and ask how many of those 5 would you like to bring in for interviews. In other words, name them finalists. Once that's completed by the 30th, we'll have a finalist list named then on Monday, May 4th. Then that will give us 2 weeks then to do background checks and reference checks and then set up a schedule. I would propose that the week of May 25th through May 29th that we have candidates in town, if we can fit it all into 1 week. We have candidates to come in and do interviews with the commission themselves. I would recommend two items. I'd recommend that there maybe be a public forum that the finalists could address, maybe put it in here at different times. One finalist addresses it, the next finalist, so you can get community input, and then we would schedule the interviews. I would also like to recommend that you all sit down in a social setting with the candidate. In other words, maybe you have dinner, and then you have the interview, formal interview after dinner. If we can do that all in that 1 week, then on the first week then of June, we could have the special meeting, or we could have it right away on the 29th or whatever. We could have a special meeting for you all to vote on your decision to hire and offer the position. That way, that would give that person June to be able to hand in a 2 week notice if they need a 2 week notice, and to make moving arrangements if they're from out of town, or make arrangements if they're from in town. That would hit the schedule of having somebody here no later than July 1st, and it certainly could move that schedule up depending on how quick we can get those people in town, if in fact they're from out of town. If they're from in town, it would certainly make it a little bit easier for travel considerations. And so I'd like for you all to consider that. They certainly don't want to put anything in concrete. If next week all 5 of you all finish looking at them and have ranked all 5 by the end of next week, we can certainly move that up, go right into looking at backgrounds and references, and then move forward from there. Does that sound like a plan that the commission would be comfortable with?
I'm happy with it.
Okay.
And we can just see if we need that full 10 days or not, or if we can do that sooner.
Right. Any of those days, Commissioner, I just wanted to leave enough room. So in other words, if on the fourth you finish finalist and we can get the backgrounds and references done that week, and let's say the finalists are from here or from around here, but we're not bringing in. We do not have any from out of the state of New Mexico. All 13 were from New Mexico. Overwhelming majority from inside Cibola County. And so it may be that we could shrink that to where once the backgrounds are done, we can move that up a week or two if we could have the interviews, and then maybe by mid-May, or that you all could have a special meeting and name that person, knowing that that person, if employed at this time, would need to probably give some notice at work and then get started here. Okay, Mr. Chairman and Commissioners, that's all in the manager's report. Thank you.
Comment from staff? Comments from commission? Commissioners?
That's the only thing that I wanted to say there is, you know, we can get those checks done as quickly as we can.
Yeah. Well, there is just a matter of Debbie's just going to read it, you know, go through. What, how long does she have to go through the applications?
I've asked her to have them completed by the end of this week, so we could start fresh Monday morning with you all looking at them. And that way, we know that they all meet the requirements and the qualifications. She has put together a file folder where they'll all be kept in one packet. Let's say two of you all show up at the same time, be able to take separate ones out, put them back into the tanks. And so we want to make it as easy and as quick for you as we can.
What were you thinking? Were you
I'm okay with starting the process on Monday. Yeah.
Anybody else? Robert? 13, executive closed session to discuss the limited personnel matters pursuant to section 10-15-1 H2 Mexico SA 1978. So what is that?
Mr. Chairman, it's actually it doesn't make a difference on the stated one. Actually, we're going to talk about pending litigation, and there will be. I can announce that there will not be any request for a commission decision, nor will their commission come out of session and take any vote whatsoever. So they will just come out of session and then, as by law, publicly convene. I say that so if someone does not want to wait around to see if there's going to be a vote or not, there's not any vote to be asked for, recommended, or to take on after this.
I motion we go into executive closed session to discuss limited personnel matters pursuant to section 10-15-1 H2 NMSA 1978 compact.
Second. We have a second. Jack, how do you vote?
Yes.